Welcome to part two of our series on encryption and security. We're going to get into practical issues now and talk about how you can make sure your experience on the internet is as secure as it can be. In this first video, we're going to cover probably the most important issue and usually the biggest vulnerability, passwords. And as we'll see, the security of your passwords on your banking and e-commerce sites, as well as anywhere else on the web where you log in, is dependent on two things. How good you are at selecting a strong password, and how good a job the web server does at securing it. First, let's take a look at passwords that are not stored securely. One of the biggest examples has to be the password fiasco on Adobe's website in October of 2013. As we look at what Adobe did wrong, we'll also see what users did wrong in selecting a password. Hackers managed to get into Adobe's website and steal their user database, where some 38 million users had their information exposed. This included the encrypted passwords, but the encryption was done improperly. Adobe used a block cipher to encrypt the passwords, and if you remember from part 1, a block cipher has a problem if you don't use an initialization vector to start a blockchain. Remember this picture of Tux and how information was leaked out? The exact same thing happened here. Here's a dump of a few of the records stolen via the hack. Left to right, separated by dash pipe dash delimiters, are the user ID number, the username, which most didn't have because the emails were used to log in, the email address, which has been excised from this example, the encrypted password, and the password hint. The password hint was in plain text, not encrypted, so it served as a basis for deciphering passwords. The encrypted password was a block cipher, which worked in 8-byte chunks. Here's what it looks like formatted a bit better. The encrypted password has been converted to hexadecimal and displayed in 8-byte chunks to show what's going on. The top three, as the password hints show, is simply 123456, which, as a Mel Brooks movie once observed, was the kind of thing an idiot would have on his luggage. Here's the point. Every password that was 123456 got encrypted the exact same way. Remember that if you use the same key on the same data without introducing any entropy, you'll get the same encrypted result. So thanks to these hints, we now know everyone who used the password 123456. Another commonly used password is password. You can see here that, again thanks to people being too free and open with their hints, my favorite is rhymes with assword. We now know how the word password gets encrypted and can now tell any user that has used the password of password. Notice that password is 8 characters, but there's a second block. The reason why is that when you put a password or anything else into a database, there's an extra byte at the end that's an end of field marker. That second block doesn't have any password data, it's just the EOF. So now we have information on how long other passwords are. If there's only one block, then the password is less than 8 characters. If it's exactly 8, the second block will be encrypted this way. If it's more than 8, it'll have a different second block. Remember that we do not want to give hackers any clue as to how long the password is. But it does. In this next group of passwords, although the first block is different, the second block we can spot as the encrypted EOF. So we know this password is precisely 8 characters. And in fact, the hints let us know that this password is simply 123456789. So really, the password is broken down into groups of 8 encrypted characters. This gives the hacker a big advantage. If he wanted to brute force a password, he would only have to do 8 characters at a time. Once he got the first 8 characters, he would put those aside and just work on the next 8. This is really bad. You want password cracking to be an all-or-nothing prospect. You either get the entire password or nothing at all. Moreover, since all these passwords were encrypted the same way, if you used one of these popular and insecure passwords, even if you were sufficiently cryptic with your password hint, you were vulnerable if someone else used a giveaway hint because your password was encrypted the same way. Needless to say, this is not the way to secure passwords. We've already seen how to do it in part 1. Hash the password, don't encrypt it. With a good hashing algorithm, there will be no clues given to the hacker as to how long the password is. But you'll still have this problem of people using the same password. Remember that the whole idea is that, since there's no decrypting a hash, the same password must result in the same hash. So if you use a password that rhymes with assword, and so do a lot of other people, and they give that away in the hints, they'll know that's your password too. The way to get around this is to use a salt. This is simply a random number associated with each user account, which gets appended to the password. So even if two people use the same password, they'll result in different hashes. When the password is checked, the password the user types gets the same salt appended to it, and the hashes of the salted passwords are compared. Another way to secure their users' passwords would be to use shadow passwords. The idea is that there are a lot of processes that need various pieces of user data, like their email address, but only one, the login process, that needs the passwords. So what you do is make a separate table for the user's passwords, and only the login process has access to that. So in that case, simply stealing the table of user data would not give them any way of cracking the passwords. They'd have to get the shadow file as well, which can be kept more secure. So far, we've covered how passwords should and should not be stored. They should be hashed, not encrypted. They should be salted with a random number or sequence of characters, and whenever possible, the passwords should be kept in a separate table, secured from everything except the processes that absolutely need it. In the next video, Alice has created a password on Bob's server. Bob has done everything right in storing the password in a salted hash, but nonetheless, Eve has managed to get a hold of the hash of Alice's password. So how does Eve use that to get Alice's password? Stay tuned and find out. And in the video after that, we'll look in more detail at how passwords should be stored on servers and some of the stupid things they do which can compromise your password no matter how good it is.